Hi, everyone. It's Stephanie with the patient story. And first, I want to say thank you to all of you who dropped those well wishes in the comments in the last video. I want to start off with a good update. Finally got that negative COVID test about a week after testing positive. Today, I just finished that 5-day course of Paxlovid, and that's the point of this video because there are so many questions about it. I talked to top doctors, some cancer specialists, as well as the main focus here, an infectious diseases specialist at one of the most renowned healthcare centers out there, UCSF. So hopefully get the answers that you'll be looking for. Now, the video is to address four really key questions. The first one is, who should be on Paxlovid? The second is, how can we get access to it? And by the way, this one's actually really interesting. I learned you don't need the typical prescription necessarily. The third is, the Paxlovid combination is so new. Is it safe? And the last one is a personal one. It's, you know, for people who aren't currently in cancer treatment, but used to be, do we qualify as immunocompromised? Are we in that priority group for access to treatments like Paxlovid? I know personally, I've had conflicting feelings about it. As usual, we will have time codes. Just go down there to the description. If you click there, then you'll see some time codes. You can skip directly to the question that you're most interested in getting the answer to. And don't forget to please leave a comment, actually, this time around. We'd really love to hear your experience with COVID drugs, since, again, so much of this is new. So first, it is really important to note that this is not medical advice. This is my experience, as well as the words from a few of these interviews with these doctors and their opinions. So remember to consult your own provider. It is not a substitution. A quick refresher. Again, we're talking about Paxlovid, which comes in this box. It's, you know, antiviral oral pills that are currently free for people who are prescribed it because it's being distributed by the government for mild to moderate cases of COVID-19. This is for adults and for kids 12 and older who weigh at least 88 pounds, who are at a higher risk of progressing to severe COVID-19. And again, we will tackle this definition of what this means in terms of who's higher risk. Paxlovid is still investigational, which means it's still being studied. So there is not a whole ton of information out there, which is, again, why I wanted to try and at least quickly and responsibly do a video on it. Paxlovid actually comes with 5 dose sheets, 3 pills in the morning on the yellow side, 3 pills for nighttime at the blue side. And that's supposed to be done 5 days straight for a total sum of 30 pills altogether for the entire course. Now, it actually contains 2 different pills, 2 different drugs, ritonavir and nirmatrelvir. One is a new drug and one isn't. Here's Dr. David Nguyen, assistant professor of medicine and infectious diseases at University of California, San Francisco.
There's a novel antiviral that has efficacy against the SARS-CoV-2 virus. And then there's this other drug in there that is an antiviral, doesn't have much effect, but it actually boosts the effect, in this ritonavir, which has been around for decades and we have a lot of experience with. So it's not even a totally novel package, even though there is one part of the drug is novel in there.
So my experience is, I started taking Paxlovid on day 2 of COVID symptoms anyway, and those symptoms were coughing and that was worsening. There was a low grade fever, I'd say like 99 to 100. I had chills, body aches, and overall definitely fatigue. My primary care physician had told me, with my history of lymphoma treatment, she really thought that I needed to be on it. And so I was really grateful to her for being so attentive. She also reminded me that the sooner you take an antiviral after the first symptoms appear, the better. And actually, for Paxlovid, you do have to take it, or you're supposed to take it, within 5 days of those first symptoms. About 1 hour after taking my first 3 pills of Paxlovid, I got that bitter metallic taste that I had described as, well, I had agreed with other people who had written grapefruit with a bitter taste, like with soap or something. It's a very odd sort of taste. And at first I thought it was nothing, but it did actually prevent me from sleeping the first couple of nights because it was pretty bad and I felt nauseated. And the more I coughed, every time I coughed, actually, it felt that taste even worse. But it did get better. And I don't know if it's just because I got used to it. And I even resorted to just imagining that I had just eaten a grapefruit to try and help mentally get through it. Days one and two, I also did have muscle aches and pains, which they do warn you about. My coughing continued. And actually at the end, a little bit worrisome was there was a lot of phlegm. And I still don't know if that's quote normal or not, or if it's just allergies. And actually, even though I finished, I still feel congestion. You can hear it a little bit, but the coughing did get less frequent. And over the last couple of days, the aches did stop as well as the fatigue. And again, got the negative test after completing the course. On to the top question. The first overall is who should be on Paxlovid, or then there's another antiviral out there, the molnupiravir. Dr. Nguyen says, if you're feeling sick, very sick, first of all, especially if you're having trouble breathing, you should go to urgent care or an emergency room. And that also could be, you know, if your oxygenation levels are low, if you have one of those oxygen, the pulse oximeters, where you put on your finger and the reading, you know, Dr. Nguyen says, if after some breathing, after for at least a few seconds, the reading is 94 below, that's another sort of red flag to watch out for.
But if you start having other warning signs that we, you know, send to people emergency room for all the time, like if you have chest pain, lightheaded dizziness, and you're passing out, you know, which would be indicative of low blood pressure, you know, these are other reasons to go get checked out anyways. And so I wouldn't delay.
But if you are experiencing mild to moderate symptoms of COVID-19 and you're trying to, you know, stop from getting sicker, there are these two antiviral pills that are out there now. So one, the main one here, Paxlovid that we're talking about, and two, molnupiravir, or the trade name Lagevrio.
Probably the better one is Paxlovid in the sense that we have a little bit better data on it. Most people will qualify for that if they, particularly if they've had a cancer, if they have any problems with their immune system, or if they're over a certain age and in a high risk group, then sort of the first line is this drug called Paxlovid. Now, it does have some interactions with other medications. So if you're on medications that can't be changed or can't be stopped, then usually you wouldn't use Paxlovid. But then there's the second drug, molnupiravir, which is also available. And sometimes if one's not available, the other one would be available. So really, it kind of depends on what's actually locally available to you.
And on the note of accessibility, Dr. Nguyen actually taught me something incredibly interesting. I didn't know this before. You don't actually need your typical doctor's prescription to get Paxlovid. Let's say you cannot get a hold of your primary care doctor or someone in the healthcare system. You can go to a health clinic or pharmacy where if you test positive, you don't need a prescription and you can get access to Paxlovid if you qualify. And to find a nearby location, what you do is go online and search COVID therapeutics. That's COVID therapeutics. And then the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services website pops up. It should be the first result. Once you click that website, you go to find a test to treat location. And then once that page pops up, you put in your address or your zip code. And what that will do is show you the locations that have this test to treat option. And actually many of them allow you to book an appointment right then and there online. So that is very convenient. And by the way, if you are really high risk, Dr. Nguyen wanted to add that there are still monoclonal antibodies for people who get COVID-19.
And that's an injection. And so that can be actually quite nice also because it's a one-time treatment and then you're covered. And so the data is really strong for all of these therapeutics in terms of, preventing progression to hospitalization, in particular to death, but more probably equally importantly, you're going to feel better faster. Your symptoms will resolve faster. We know that it decreases viral shedding as well. And so in theory and in probably in practice, this data will come out that it's going to also prevent transmission. And so that's important if you have, you know, kids at home or other people, you know, living with you that you can't isolate from.
So question three is Paxlovid, this combination of pills is so new. Even I wondered at times, is it really safe to take? We know that it's still being studied and that the results of the clinical trial that led to the emergency use authorization were released in December of last year, December 2021. And they did, the numbers did show some promising results. So the group was randomized to either take Paxlovid or be on a placebo. And compared to placebo, Paxlovid reportedly reduced risk of hospitalization or death from any cause by about 88-89%. And there was no death reported in that Paxlovid group, while there were 12 deaths reported in the placebo arm. But also in the literature that's given to everyone prescribed Paxlovid, it's like a packet of white paper stapled together, is this line, quote, "Not many people have taken Paxlovid. Serious and unexpected side effects may happen. Paxlovid is still being studied, so it is possible that all of the risks are not known at this time." And also, I knew that the clinical trial, I'd read that the clinical trial at the end of last year was done on unvaccinated and high-risk patients. I am vaccinated and boosted, and with, you know, I figure there's probably plenty of people who are like me who are on Paxlovid. But Dr. Nguyen says, despite the difference in the clinical trial population, the efficacy of Paxlovid should still apply to everyone.
And what we saw is that when those folks got the antiviral Paxlovid, they had at least a 10-fold reduction in fact, nobody who got Paxlovid died. But they also had a massive reduction in needing to even go into the hospital in the first place. And I think that that's really what shows that this has strong antiviral therapeutic benefits. And so that extends to you whether or not you have an immune response. So even if you've been vaccinated previously or been infected previously and have some preformed immunity, the Paxlovid will still work against the virus. And so it's sort of almost like a belt and suspenders approach. You know, you're keeping your pants up, you keep your immune system up, and you knock out the virus as best you can.
And lastly, again, this is admittedly personal for me and something that I've thought about when it came to everything from who's a high-risk group for getting the vaccinations or boosters, is the question of, you know, me and my status as a someone who'd gone through cancer treatment before, do I qualify as immunocompromised and get access to treatments reserved for higher risk groups? In my situation, I had a stage 3 non-Hodgkin lymphoma. I did undergo hundreds of hours of chemotherapy, which included rituximab, but that was approaching 5 years ago. So what does that mean?
Rituximab actually is an agent that's used to knock out B cells that are cancerous B cells. But unfortunately, it also knocks out, healthy, normal B cells. And those B cells are what are necessary to produce our antibodies. And so when those get knocked out, it takes out our a major wall of defense against viruses like COVID. And so if you've been treated with rituximab, even if it's been many years, you could actually not mount a full immune response. So your vaccination might not have been as effective. If you are not sure which category you fall into, it's really good, you know, even right now to just reach out to your provider and say, hey, you know, am I moderate risk? Am I high risk? Is there anything else I should be doing? Should I be getting another booster? Should I be getting a vaccine in the first place? The answer is always yes. But should I be getting a booster, you know, a second booster even potentially? Should I be considering Evusheld? Am I high risk enough at the moment that I should be considering every show? That's generally reserved for people who are like actively undergoing treatment. And if I get sick, if, you know, heaven forbid I get sick, you know, should I be really immediately reaching for some of these therapies? And the answer, if you are even moderately immunocompromised, is yes, you should be reaching for these therapies.
So on this note of cancer, I spoke with several cancer specialists across the country who said many of their current patients, especially multiple myeloma and CLL or chronic lymphocytic leukemia, have been given the antibody cocktail Evusheld to help protect them from getting COVID-19. But that if any of the patients did get an infection, they would have to stop therapy from happening anyway and prescribe, and they have prescribed their patients Paxlovid with an overall good response so far. Dr. Kerry Rogers, who's a hematologist and CLL specialist at the Ohio State Comprehensive Cancer Center, wanted to remind people that Paxlovid and other drugs like it are not a replacement for the vaccine, that this is an additional tool. And she also said, quote, "Paxlovid is an excellent addition to our treatment options along with monoclonal antibodies. I think the Paxlovid and antibody treatments are a good reason I tell my patients to get tested for COVID as soon as they feel ill. That way, if they have COVID, they can be offered treatment earlier into the illness when treatment is likely to be more effective. The main concern with Paxlovid is drug interactions, so anyone prescribed it should make sure they check with their pharmacist and that their medication list is up to date. And by the way, right now, Pfizer, which manufactures this Paxlovid combination, has a phase 2 and phase 3 clinical trial of the two drug combination for children between the ages of 6 to 17. So we'll see what happens. Hopefully this video was helpful in some way. And hopefully those of you who are watching this or reading this right now will not need something like Paxlovid. Although I do think that it is so nice that we're at a place where we have all these different options to help prevent from more serious cases. So for now, take good care and see you next time.